minister to your sheep, Lord, to be a shepherd. I ask, O Lord, that you will pour out your Holy Spirit on him today, that he would speak the words of Jesus that we need to hear. And I pray also for us, Lord, that you would give us ears to hear and wisdom to know whether or not this is the man you called to be our pastor, to be our shepherd. We ask these things in Jesus' name for his glory and honor. Amen. I thought that he should fill one out on us and hand it in.
I'll just set that there and we'll see how it goes later. You know who we are? At least you know our names. My wife is shy, but that's okay. He didn't want to pick on her, but I'm not afraid to. This lady over here, we've been married for 37 years. And I've told her that I'm pretty sure if she just hang in there till for 40 years, she gets sainthood. So we're going to see how that works. But appreciate it very much. This is my first time at this, as it was said. I came to the Lord at the tender age of 35. I had a learning disability when it came to things of the Spirit. And God has been gracious and called me into this crazy, wonderful life of shepherding people, and I'm just excited to be able to be here and share with you what God's laid on my heart. So let's get to her, all right? I titled this message, If the Path is Straight, Then What's That Hill Doing There? Okay? And we're going to be looking at Proverbs chapter 3, very familiar verses, but I'm hoping we can look at it from a little different angle and maybe learn something. I know I did. Pretty easy for me to learn things. I mean, the Lord, I feel so ignorant when it comes to the things of the Bible. Every time I read a scripture, it's like, I didn't know that was there. That's so cool. So this one came up a while ago, and I just wanted to share it. One of the things that I've taken up in the last few years is bike riding. And we moved to the city, and we live about 4.5 miles away from the church, and driving back and forth on Leonard Avenue, I was thinking, well, I could ride a bike. It's only 4 miles. And when you're sitting in the car and you're going down the road, it's, well, this is pretty flat. Well, there's a couple of hills, but, you know, they're not bad. So I bought a bike. And my first trip there, I realized that it's uphill all the way there. I mean, some of those hills are just sneaky. A sneaky hill is one that starts here, and you pedal along, and you're like, what? And you look up, and there's just this little, I didn't notice that driving in the car. So, and then you get to the big hill. And you're like, this is a dumb idea. But you pedal up a ways and you get up and you're pushing the bike up there going, what kind of a fool are you? But, so I began to understand that, you know, riding a bike was not as easy as I thought. But over time, I got to where I could actually start going up these hills without acting like I was going to have a coronary. And I got to where I didn't have to walk quite as far up these hills. And out of those times of questioning my sanity and questioning whether my heart was going to hold out while I went up these hills, these verses came to mind. And I want to talk about verse 7, but let's look at the whole thing for just a minute. It says, Proverbs chapter 3, starting in verse 5. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, lean not on your own understanding, and in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. Has anybody heard those verses before? Well, we're in the right house. Good. All right. Wonderful, wonderful words. Verse 7 says, do not be wise in your own eyes, fear the Lord, and shun evil. Now, just kind of set that over there, and we'll get back to that. Because first of all, I want to clear up some confusion that there might be about what life in Christ is supposed to be. I hear people say a lot of things. You know, people in trouble going through some stuff, and they'll say, if you just have Jesus, if you just ask Jesus in your heart, your life is going to be all right. Your life is going to be good. You won't have these problems. And I'm like, what planet are you on? Or what am I doing wrong? Because my life is full of troubles. I've got problems. My wife has more because she's married to me. So, you know, I'm trying to figure this out. See, now the Lord promises that if we trust in him completely, trust in his wisdom and not ours, and give him all the glory in what we do, that he will make our paths straight. I can appreciate that. I love a straight path. For my bike ride, I went to the end of my driveway, I turned left, I went a half mile, I turned left, and I went to the church. It was straight. There was not a curve in it. Knew exactly where to go. But the hills. Oh my goodness, the hills. So after I did that a couple years, I decided that I would, some people saw me riding a bike and they said, "Pastor, you like to ride the bike?" I said, "Yeah." "Well, I'd like to do that with you sometime." So I said, "Okay." So one day I got up at church. I said, "Starting Wednesday, we're going to have pedaling with Pastor. And anybody that wants to come and pedal with Pastor, we'll go down and do that." Do you know the first question I get asked when I said that? "Are there any hills?" I'm like, "Well, of course there's hills. We live in Michigan, for one, but, you know, are there hills?" It's like nobody wants to face the hills. But I was learning that in the hills was where the growth was. I got stronger, and I know that they had to leave, so I'm going to forgive them. But, you know, the hills were good in that they strengthened me. Now, I say that, and you understand this, because I want to be very clear on this. While I'm sweating my way up that hill, no time is I going, "Thank you, Lord, for this hill. Could you give me a bigger one?" Okay? But I appreciated what the hills were doing. So, straight, but not easy. That's what the Christian life is like. If we're going to follow God's word, he's going to make it very clear that this is the path. Go this way. But at no point is he going to say, "Because there's not a problem on that road." As a matter of fact, I don't know about you, but it seems like the more determined I am to follow Jesus, the more difficult it becomes. How many of you have done this? Lord, I tell you that starting tomorrow, I'm going to get up and I'm going to read my Bible for 30 minutes and pray for 30 minutes every day. Because I love you and I'm going to grow to you, grow closer to you. How many make it past day three? Uh-huh. I guess I can cancel that therapy appointment. It's not just me. Okay, good. Why is that? Because there's forces in this world that don't want you to do that. Right? There's bumps and there's hills and there's troubles. So we're very clear about the way we should go, but there's this guy named Satan. There's evil in this world. We live in a broken world. See, we're born into this world, and we look around and say, "Ah, this is cool. This is normal." This is not normal. This is not the way the world's supposed to be. It is broken, and it's not right. And that's why Jesus is coming again. If the world wasn't broken, Jesus wouldn't need to come back, right? Anybody here looking forward to Jesus coming again? Still in the right house. This is good. So Satan doesn't want you to follow Jesus. So, following Jesus, following his path is hard, but it's so worth it. And I want to make sure we understand that Jesus never promised us it was going to be easy. So the people who tell you that your life is going to be wonderful and easy, I don't think they've listened to what Jesus had to say. In Matthew 16:24, he says this, "If anyone would come after me, he must deny himself, pick up your cross, the implement of suffering, and follow me." Now there's an invitation. Come suffer with me. Who then? Are there any hills? You know? All right. In John 15, some of the last words that Jesus is telling to his apostles as he's getting ready to leave. He says, "If the world hates you, remember that it hated me first." Well, that sounds encouraging. In 16, "There will come a time when they will kill you thinking they are doing God's service." This does not sound like the prosperity gospel to me. "When trouble comes," in James, not if, but when trouble comes, we're supposed to count it as joy. Because we build character in the struggle. there's value in the hill. Now, this path is never easy. It was not intended to be. And this world that we live in makes sure of that. There are so many distractions that we can let get in our way. There's so many little obstacles and hills that we allow us to turn away from where God wants us to go, from the path. However, if we can stick to that path, that there is joy in the path. And where does that joy come from? Where's the joy in this path? Well, number one is the fact that you are never alone. You know, as long as you have Jesus Christ, you are never alone. It is Emmanuel, God with us. There's no place that you can go where Jesus isn't. Now, remember that when you're trying to hide those little sins, all right? Even the big ones. There's no place. We are never alone. So we are not struggling alone. You do not travel in your own strength. We are empowered through the Holy Spirit, through God's Word. There is power in following Jesus. So we're not traveling in our own strength, and we do not have to navigate in our own wisdom. Whew. If you want to get lost, follow me. Okay? Yeah, I can go the wrong way. Apparently that is the wrong way. I'm going to come over here. So you know how easy it is to walk in the wrong way? Anyway. So we're not doing this alone. There's some promises that I want you to think about while you're facing those hills and those mountains that are coming up. I will never leave you nor forsake you. So when is he going to leave us? Never. What are you going through that is so bad, that is so horrible, that is so awful that Jesus cannot go with you? Nothing. He's always there. I've been in hospitals. And people, when they're dying, and Jesus is there. Some of the greatest comforts in life is knowing that Jesus is there. There's no place. He also says, I will not have you orphans. I send the Comforter. I send you the Spirit. And then he also says, cast your cares upon him because he cares for you. We have this wonderful, amazing God that says, I've got this straight path for you to follow. But it's not going to be easy. And there's going to be times when you're going to want to just look at that hill in front of you and go, you've got to be kidding me. I'm going to go get a burger. No, you stay on the path because you're not alone. And you're not doing it in your own strength. Because if you look at that hill in your own strength, you might as well sit down and take a nap because you're not going to do it. But you don't do it in your own strength. Jesus is there. The Holy Spirit is there to strengthen us. Let me tell you the first time I understood this. This is a side illustration, forgive me, but you're going to get it anyway. I had been a Christian about 6 months when my brother-in-law committed suicide and went over to the house and was kind of helping clean up and things like that and helping save my sister a few days to kind of get things organized. And my brother-in-law slipped into a pretty dark place. And so as they're going through the house trying to sort things out, we kept finding little things that indicated just how fallen and depraved he'd become. And it was like you're already under this dark cloud of this death. And then all of a sudden this thing comes along and just slams you. And then something else slams you and you try to get up and boom. And it got to the point where there I was crawling around on my knees basically, unable to stand up, and I went outside to the picnic table, and I'm just broken. There's nothing left of me, and I'm like, I've been a Christian about 6 months, didn't know a lot of verses, but there's one that my wife, who'd been a Christian for a long time, had on our bedstand that said, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. So that became my mantra. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. I can stand up because Christ will give me the strength. I can walk back into that house and do what needs to be done next because God will give me strength. I can stand at that graveside with my sister and her little girl and mourn because God will give me, Jesus strengthens me. You are not alone. Never forget that. So I don't care what side of the hill you're facing. And you're going to be facing, if you're not facing one now, you will be. That's the wonder of it. They're unavoidable. I digress. So how do we travel this path and avoid being overwhelmed by the hills? Well, it says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. First of all, you know where to go. I'm very clear about that. We need to follow Jesus. And in our country today, with so many directions that people are trying to tell you to go and follow Jesus, we need to make sure that we are grounded in God's word so that we can walk the straight path. We have to be on the right path. Next. So this is why verse 7 is so important. See, 5 and 6 give you the tools. But if you don't have verse 7, you don't have the instructions on how to use the tools. Okay? So if somebody's going to give you a tool, they better tell you how to use it. Otherwise, well, there's all sorts of terrible accidents that happen with a skill saw. Okay? So let's look at what it takes. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Lean not on your own understanding. Man. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Has anybody ever done anything foolish? Oh, I hope so. Good. Phew. Usually it's because you're trying to do things your own way, right? You got somebody trying to, oh, don't do that. I've got it off there. We think we're smarter than we are. And as much as we know we think we're smart and wise, we still fall into that. So that way leads to trouble. Doing things in our own wisdom, they lead to trouble every time. The hills take you out because you're trying to do them on your own. You're trying to get around this obstacle and in your own strength, you're not going to do it. In your own wisdom, you're just not that smart. The book of Judges makes that very clear. It's one of my favorite books because it represents my life and my struggle so much. Things are going good. I start leaning on my own wisdom. Find myself in a mess. And I cry out, God, save me. He does. I say, phew. I'm glad I learned from that. And then I find myself crying out again, God, save me. What was the problem there? There was no king, and everybody was doing what was right in their own eyes. So, we got to not lean on our own understanding, but lean on his. Lean on the word. Make sure we are following him. Then we have to fear the Lord. And that's not cringing in our closets under our beds in fear that the Lord might see us. That's not what that means. That means to be in awe of the Lord. That means to learn to seek his presence and his will in his life. The best place that you can be is in the will of God. Because there's no other place to be. Because anything outside the will of God is going to take you someplace you don't want to go. Someplace where you're not supposed to be. So we got to fear the Lord. We got to learn to revel in his glory. We need to understand how big and immense and incredible and wonderful and amazing and wise and wonderful this God is. Because there's not a hill out there that's bigger than him. There's not a hill out there that he can't get you up, around, over, or through, right? If God is with us, who can stand against us? So we need to not be wise in our own eyes. We got to fear the Lord. Then we have to shun evil. I got a confession to make. I'm a sinner. Saved by grace, but I'm a sinner. I'm not perfect. I could get my wife up here to testify, but it would be another hour. Okay? Paul writes in Romans 7, my life story. That thing that I want to do, I don't do. The thing that I don't want to do, that's the thing that I do. And it drives me crazy. I love the Lord, but how do we shun evil? Well, James 4, verse 7 says it simply, submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Submit yourself to God. Say, God, your will and not mine. Your path and not mine. I see the path up ahead, and that's one big hill, God, but I'm going to walk that path, and I'm going to walk with you because I know I'm not alone. I know you're big enough to get me to the top of it. That's the way I'm going. And when the devil sees that, he's like, well, I got nothing here. See, the devil takes the path of least resistance, just like electricity. So you want to make sure that you got some resistance. Because if you resist him, he'll flee from you. The only way you resist the devil is to submit yourself to God. See, because the truth is, Satan doesn't want you to trust God. As a matter of fact, he doesn't want you to grow in your faith. He'd love it if you just stay there, right there where you are, right now, just kind of contented. Not really growing, not really telling anybody you're a Christian, not really trying to do anything to further the kingdom, you're just sitting here. Satan ain't going to bother you. You're right where he wants you. So, Satan uses obstacles to tempt us to forsake God. Puts things in our path sometimes. And at times he seems to set traps for us. Some of these brief little encounters, the little bumps in the road that we run into. One thing I learned about bike riding, even a little hill can take you out if you're not careful. If you've been riding your bike for 20, 23 miles and you're riding along there and you're not really noticing, all of a sudden a little grade comes up, you get about halfway up and you're like, uh-oh, those legs are burning, you know? Sometimes our obstacles are just little bumps. Others are bigger struggles, and they're hills. And every once in a while, you get faced a mountain. Every once in a while, you get faced a phone call, like I did, about my brother-in-law. Or you get the call from the doctor that says, your test results are in. Welcome to the wonderful world of cancer. You don't know. But every once in a while, we get thrown a mountain. Praise God, but God is bigger than the mountain, right? See, but God calls us to persevere in him. He calls us to resist. He calls us to choose him. He calls us to a life of power. Gives us the power to resist Satan. Satan has no hold on thee. Get behind me. I'm going to follow the path. Romans 5:1 says this. Romans chapter 5, it says, therefore, since we've been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we've gained access by faith into his grace, in which we now stand. And we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also rejoice in our sufferings, in our hills, in our mountains. Because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God has poured out his love onto our hearts by the Holy Spirit whom he's given us. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for us. Praise God. Is that not amazing? He loves us so much that he died for us, so that we can face any hill, any mountain in him. So, do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and shun evil. Trust and rest in the Holy Spirit to get you through that. In Christ, we have the power to endure the bumps, the hills, and the mountains. See, the Holy Spirit comes alongside us and helps us with the hills and stuff, but the way is clear, but it's not smooth and it's not easy. And I think another thing that happens in this broken world that we live in is that we forget that the Holy Spirit is there. Kind of like we talked about in the video this morning, you know, things we talked about. When things are going really good, we tend to take credit for it. We tend to, I'm doing pretty good. And then things fall apart. Well, I got one last biking illustration. How I learned this through biking. I haven't been riding for a little while. I got lazy. Yes, occasionally I get lazy. And I told my wife, so I'm going to go for a ride. I'm just going to go down to the park and back. It's about six miles down to this park. And there's a bike path that I could take. Now, the cool thing about this is that it's mostly bike trails, and it's got a few nice big hills. As a matter of fact, going down to the park, the last mile is just one big downhill. Whew. So I get on my bike, and I take off. And I'm going, man, I haven't done this for a while. And I start going. And it is amazing, people. I give the bike a good kick, and man, I would just take off. And I'm just flying, and it's like nothing. I'm going, man, I'm getting good at this. And I take off, and I get all the way down to the park. I'm going down the hills. He said, man, I'm doing so good. I'm going to do a couple laps around the park. It's about a 3-mile lap around the park. I'm going to do a couple laps because, man, I'm amazing. So the bike trail kind of parallels into this loop around this park. And I decide that I want to turn around and go this way because it starts on the hill first. I want to test myself. So I'm going this way, and I slow down, and I turn around, and I go to take off, and my bike stops. And I'm going. And I realize there's about a 15-20 mile an hour wind blowing right in my face. It had been in my back the whole time, but I didn't realize it. All right, so all this time, I just, look at me, oh, I'm doing great, yeah. I turn around, I stop, and then it hits me. You've got to go up that hill in this wind. And I thought, do I call my wife? Have her call me a little kid? Well, no. I said, no, I'm going to tough it out. So there were people living on that road that saw this old, sweaty man pushing a bike up most of the hill going, you are crazy. Forgive me, Lord. We're like that in our spiritual life. Things go good, and the Spirit's doing some things, and we take credit for it. And all of a sudden, the truth comes out, and we're sitting there going, oh, I guess I'm not all that. And usually when you go, oh, I guess I'm not all that, there's several people around to verify it. Okay? And that's how the Lord keeps us humble, folks. That's how. And I'd love to tell you that's the only time in my whole life that's ever happened. I'm gifted in this, I'm afraid. And you are too. We all are. We're sinners. But this God, this amazing God, who loves us so much that he sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die for us. This God who loves us so much that he sent the Holy Spirit to indwell us. He says, I've got this incredible redemption plan, and I want you to be a part of it. I want you to be a part of it, where you are. And just to make your life interesting, this is how I want to do it. I, in my infinite wisdom, am going to call a bunch of people together into this building, and you're going to be a church, and you're going to love one another. And you're going to encourage one another. And you're going to pray for one another. And as you do that, and as you come together in unity, I am going to do amazing things through you. The only catch is, there are a bunch of sinners, just like you. And there are a bunch of people who are going to do some of the stupidest things. And they're going to get into foolish situations. And you've got to love them. Sound hard? Well, get this. They got to love you too. Now go and be my body. That's what a church is. Oh, praise God we are not alone in that. Do you know how long the church would last without the Spirit? Without the God, without Jesus? We'd eat each other's throats. Talking about what color the chair should be. No peace, no peace. When a church forgets that it's a church, That's the kind of stuff that happens. When you lose the unity of the Spirit and the Son and the Father, that's the kind of stuff that happens. But God says that if you listen to me, if you'll stay on the path, and you won't let the hills turn you away, you are going to have unity in me. And when you have unity in me, my will prevails. And when my will prevails, my power prevails. And when my power prevails, people that don't know me go, I want that! And you'll be right there to say, here. That's what a church is. Now my question for you is this. Are you giving the Spirit his due? Are you acknowledging God, giving the glory for all that he's doing in your life? Are you trying to take credit for it? Think about that. Because I can almost guarantee you that somewhere in your life, you're taking credit for what God's doing. You don't mean to. You don't intend to. But this is what's happened. It becomes a habit. It spills out in other things in your life. And you find yourself off the path. Or you find yourself sitting in the middle path looking at the hill going, I ain't going there. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear God and shun evil, and he will bless you, and he'll bless this church. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you so much for your word. We thank you so much that you know us so well, that you show us not only our foibles and our foolishness, but you also show us the way to go. And then in your mercy and your grace and your love for us, you say, follow me, and it will be well, even when it doesn't look well. Father, give us the courage, the strength, and the faith to follow you up every hill, knowing that you will never leave us nor forsake us. I pray this in Christ's name. Amen.